Well, welcome to another of our series of Meet the Candidates. This time we have Republican candidate for Congress, Dan Innis. I am James Pindell. And Dan, I want to thank you so much for coming in.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, in the next 30 minutes, we want to get a sense of who you are and where you're coming from. This is going to be kind of heavy on your own biography, to get a sense of where you are. And look, your campaign for Congress would be history. You'd be the first gay married Republican to be elected to the United States Congress. I heard you talk about it sometimes, and you say that people just don't bring it up when you go to these different rallies. And look, a lot of it makes sense. So we've had gay marriage in the state for 5 years. It's probably not that interesting. It is interesting that you're a Republican. But I want to go back to your biography. You have three children with a wife previously.
Yeah.
That must have been probably one of the most defining moments of your life, that moment when you left the marriage and moved to New Hampshire. Is that right? And what does that say? What can we learn about you?
I think the most defining moments of my life were having those three kids. Mm-hmm. I mean, those are big moments. But certainly it was a life change, no doubt about it. But you have to be true to who you are, and I'm a better father now because of that. I have a great relationship with my former wife. She was on the first FEC report. She's very supportive, and we're great parents together. And I think that's the important thing. Relationships are not only intact, they're terrific relationships. In fact, my oldest son lives on the third floor of our house in Portsmouth while he's getting his MBA at UNH. And it's great to have him around.
Yeah, because when I leave events, people they accept it. They're just like, how did that work? That's an interesting decision.
Meaning, how do you? Yeah. Well, it's an interesting decision, but you have to be who you are, or you'll never really. I don't want to say self-actualize, but you know, to be fully successful, I think you have to be true to yourself. And that's hard to do. And you think about, you know, when I was a teenager and coming of age, it was the 80s. It was a very different time. And I don't regret a single decision I've made. And I've always made decisions at each point in time that I thought were the right ones. And that decisions in life aren't always easy. But we have to do what's right. And I think I've done that.
Well, let's back up a little bit. Where did you grow up?
I grew up in Ohio. I was born in Columbus back in the 60s. We won't necessarily say what year, though people can figure that out. My father was a printer. He printed the morning newspaper, the Columbus Citizen Journal. My mom was a secretary. Very humble background. We were poor, but didn't know it. Family surrounded by love. 50-mile radius had all of my family members, including five great-grandparents that were around. The last great-grandparent passed away in 2000 when I was 36. And 2 weeks ago, I lost my grandfather, the last one, at 93. And if you've heard my stump speech, he was a part of that.
Talk to us about that. You used to read Forbes magazine.
I did. I read Forbes magazine.
He had the subscription.
Yeah, I couldn't afford it.
And how far away did he live from you guys?
Oh, maybe a mile.
Oh, okay.
And I used to go there after school a couple days a week and on weekends. And he was really a second father to me, and Grandma was a second mother. And they had a huge impact on my life. Really, really enormous respect for these two folks and what they did. Grandpa taught himself engineering after World War II. And you know, moved up through the ranks at a company and did some amazing things. And Grandma took care of all of us. She was a phenomenal, loving woman.
But you had this really special, I'm sorry to hear about your grandfather, you had a very special relationship with him.
Absolutely. Yeah, and with all of the family. I mean, it was a terrific family. I have a brother and sister that I adore, and life was really good. You know, we didn't travel, we couldn't afford it. You know, when I was 18, I think the furthest I had been was Florida. That was the furthest south. The furthest north was Lake Erie. The furthest west was Dayton. The furthest east was Zanesville. So, you know, but I read a lot, I learned a lot, and I really owe a lot to my family and my parents for what they've helped me to become.
So how did you end up becoming a business school professor?
Well, I went into the corporate world after my MBA. I worked for the company that made, at the time, had Listerine, Trident, Certs, Rolaids. I was in transportation and distribution.
Which city was this?
This was in Morris Plains, New Jersey.
Uh-huh.
And after a couple of years of that, I decided I really wanted to continue to...
So congratulations, you made it through Pennsylvania for someplace further west.
Yes, I did. It was exciting. My first airplane flight was into Newark, New Jersey from Columbus, Ohio, and that is a scenic route. But after a couple of years of that, I really wanted to pursue different lines of thought and explore things in a deeper way. You know, what makes business tick? What makes consumers tick? And that's when I decided to go back for the PhD.
And you studied what?
My major was marketing. Mm-hmm. I had a minor in consumer behavior. And then my dissertation was in the distribution channel, where I looked at buyer behavior. And don't get me started on it, because we'll fill the whole time with that. But I was really interested in getting product to market and understanding how buyers think and behave and what drives that behavior.
And is there a certain strategy there that you apply to this campaign for Congress?
Well, you know, I think when you look at marketing or you look at buyer behavior, the important thing to remember is there are several key elements that you need to think about. One is thinking, right? You want to make arguments to people about the product or about the service or about the candidate. Mm-hmm. You also want to think about feelings, and you want them to feel positive emotions toward the product or the candidate or whatever it is. But all of those things, the thinking and the feeling, has to translate into action. And without that, nothing happens, right? People can think positive things about your product and like it, but not buy it. And if that's the case, you haven't really accomplished your goal. So with politics, you want people to understand what you're saying, fiscal restraint, for example. You want them to feel positive things about you as a person, but then you want them to take that into the voting booth and do the right thing. So there's an awful lot that translates, absolutely. It's a little different, but the concepts are the same.
Why did you decide you wanted to actually go into administration to become became a dean at UNH?
Right. Well, as with a lot of administrators in academia, it was an accident. And it really was. I was a professor.
The last one who didn't say no.
Right, basically. I was a professor, then became a department chair because we just needed one. And I said, okay, I'll step up and I'll do it for 3 years. I did it for two.
This is in Ohio? Where's
this was at Ohio University, mm-hmm. The Ohio University Bobcats. Yep. And did that for 2 years, and then the dean asked me to be associate dean. I thought about it for a weekend and said, okay. And then from there, launched to dean. And it really wasn't planned. It was, you know, opportunities presented themselves, and I had the right skill set, and I decided that I should do it to try to make the institutions better and to try to help students. And that's, you know, some of the same reasons I'm running for Congress, right? I feel I have the right skill set. I want to apply my skills and my abilities to make things better. And Washington needs fixed. And I believe that I can make a difference. I'm sure going to try.
And then you moved to New Hampshire when?
Moved to New Hampshire in 2007. Yeah, moved to UNH.
And you decided UNH because it was a great opportunity as a job?
It was a great opportunity as a job. I love the state, the live free or die mentality. Mm-hmm. And I really think, and I don't want to disparage Maine, but compared to some other states in New England.
You spent some time in Maine, right?
Yeah, I was there for 5 years. Right. Compared to some other states in Maine, I think New Hampshire gets a lot of things, or other states in New England, I think New Hampshire gets a lot of things right. The low taxes, a favorable business climate, you know, the live free or die approach, I think that's all terrific. And that's sort of the way I grew up. You know, my family values are just that. You're responsible for yourself, you should be free, and you should be driven and go do things. And I think New Hampshire has those values. I really, really like that.
So a lot of people in politics, particularly who run for Congress, may grow up idolizing certain politicians or certain governors.
Yeah.
But it sounds like you were idolizing business leaders when you're reading Forbes, talking to your grandfather.
I don't think I was idolizing a lot of people. I was paying attention to a lot of people. Mm-hmm. My first real memory of politics was Richard Nixon, right? And that was a different time. I admired his thinking. but he made some big mistakes and, of course, paid for those. And then it was Jimmy Carter. And, you know, it was hard to idolize a politician at that point in time because things were, believe it or not, maybe worse than they are today. And, but I did admire Gerald Ford. I thought he came into a very difficult situation. He settled the country and he moved us forward to that next presidential election.
That's saying something for a guy from Ohio to be giving props to a guy from Michigan.
So well, he was a football player from Michigan,
that's
no less.
That's what I'm trying to say. Yeah.
And I did get a degree at Ohio State, so yeah, it's hard. but I did admire him and what he did. But, you know, I think you can learn something from everybody. And that's what I've tried to do. Even Jimmy Carter, who, you know, probably wasn't the best president, but there are things you could learn from him. And I think in a lot of ways he's a good man, just not a good leader. And, you know, in everyone you interact with in life, you should learn something. There's something to learn from everybody.
Why did you become a Republican? I mean, what made you a Republican in the first place? Is this something new? Is this something...
Oh, no, it's not new. And you know... people who look back at my record, and I know many people have and probably are as we speak, I registered Republican at age 18. And I was disappointed because I couldn't vote for Ronald Reagan.
Was your family Republican or was it?
Dad definitely is. I didn't know when I was 18 what my mother was. Because in my family, you didn't talk about politics.
Okay.
You know, politics and religion, we don't talk about them. You should go to church, but we don't talk about it. And we don't talk politics. So. I remember Mom and Dad sometimes at odds over politics, but I've since learned Mom was indeed a Republican and still is. Probably more than Dad now, mm-hmm. as she's gotten older. The entire family wasn't Republican. My dad's stepdad was definitely a Democrat. Mm-hmm. And my grandfather that read Forbes, I never knew what he was. And the year of Reagan Carter, I asked him, you know, I broke the family
the rule,
yeah, and said, who are you going to vote for? Well, he wasn't going to let me break that rule. He said, well, it doesn't matter. They're all crooks. And I said, well, all right. So I never did learn who he voted for in that election, but I'm pretty sure it was Reagan.
You started working in your teenage years. Yep. You worked with your father in the printing press, right?
I did, yeah.
He printed a newspaper? He had his own printing press?
Well, no. He eventually started his own printing business. I was 14 or 15 when he did that. I can't remember the exact date.
Then you worked at a golf course.
Yeah, I worked in maintenance.
Do you still golf?
I haven't golfed in a couple of years, and I was never very good at it. You know,
Was it the long game or the short game was the toughest for you?
Yes. I really enjoyed being outside and you know, golfing, and I did a lot of golfing with my dad, and it was a great way for us to get to know one another better over time, and those are special memories. But I worked in maintenance, not as a caddy. As a caddy, I'd probably be almost useless. Mm-hmm. But I really enjoyed the job, and it was, you know, it was interesting because you met people on the course. You had to move aside to let them play through when you were doing work, and it was a country club, so it was a wide range of people, and very, very interesting. And again, I learned a lot from everybody I met. But I also learned on that job how to manage people, and you know, watched the head greenskeeper and how he did things. And one of my favorite people that I've ever worked with was a guy named Harry Uhl. And Harry's long gone, but Harry was he was full of wisdom. And he would share that with me because I was this, you know, type A personality guy out there trying to do things. And he would always keep me in check. And I learned from him. He's a great guy. And if any of his family happens to see this, I'm sure they'll be amazed. But I learned a lot from that guy. Really great. He was a career maintenance guy at that golf course. I don't know if he finished school. Mm-hmm. But he was an extremely important guy to me.
And when you went to UNH, what did you learn about New Hampshire, besides the fact they don't really fund their public universities all that well?
Yeah, and I think that hit me right.
Last,
well, that hit me
yes.
right between the eyes, because when I got here, one of my objectives was to help build this new business building.
Yeah.
And as I went into it, I thought, well, all right, we need a major donor, we need a whole bunch of other donors, and we'll probably get a little state help.
Mm-hmm.
No, I missed on the last one. And I think that's the thing that hits you most about New Hampshire when you get here, is that the government is so small, mm-hmm. and there's a great desire to keep it small. And I think that's a brilliant idea, because small government is good government. And I do believe that our government in New Hampshire meets our needs, and we are fairly pragmatic about it. You know, and we don't all agree with everything Concord does or doesn't do. But I do think the small government and letting people live their lives freely is the thing that struck me the most about New Hampshire. And I think it's unique in New England, that level of freedom, I'll call it, and mm-hmm. liberty-mindedness.
And then you got into the inn business. How did
yes.
that happen? Is that your husband's idea?
It was, yeah. How
did you meet your husband, by the way?
We met on an online dating site.
Really?
And I was in Orono, he was in Boston, and we met in Camden, Maine, and had lunch. And it was 2-hour lunch, and we went our separate ways and got together again about a week later, and it was terrific.
Oh,
yeah.
Good.
Yeah, it was neat. But it was, he had a store in Boston in uh-huh. the South End.
Yep.
And I was moving to New Hampshire, and we wanted to get closer together. This was probably about a year after I'd moved to New Hampshire. Mm-hmm. I guess it was just, maybe a little more than that. We bought the old Bow Street Inn and changed it to the Ale House Inn, and really didn't know what we were doing, but it was a lot of
his
fun.
His dream or your, it sounds like his dream was
his
yours.
Idea, yeah. and I got behind it and uh-huh. actually got pretty motivated by it.
Oh, you have
it.
To, I mean, it's,
yeah.
It's a pretty
yeah.
intense
well,
job.
You know, we bought it in October of 2008. Mm-hmm. Now, you think back to October of 2008.
Wow. Yeah.
It was, the
yep.
recession was beginning.
Yep.
One of the hardest hit industries was hospitality.
Sure.
People stopped traveling.
Discretionary
and
money.
Businesses
yeah.
pulled back. Yeah. So probably not a worse time to get into that business. But we made it work. We went from 29% occupancy the year we bought it to 78% the year we sold it. And I'm really proud of what we did there. And in November of last year, we sold it. And about 2.5 weeks later, we bought the old Sice Inn, which is now the Hotel Portsmouth.
It's also still in Portsmouth. That's
it
right.
opened on Monday, 32 rooms, and so far so good.
Congratulations.
Yeah, yeah. It's a lot of work, but it's also a lot of fun. And you know, when you're creating something unique and special and meeting a demand in the market that isn't presently being met, that's a lot of fun.
There's been a lot of development in Portsmouth.
There has been, and the city's struggling with that right now. You know, what is the right balance there, and how do we do it? I am generally pro-development. I think it has to be done responsibly, and I think the city will continue to work through that.
So how did you come up with the idea of running for Congress? I guess it's reported your husband and told you to just go for it.
Yeah, he did. He kind of pushed me over the edge. It was a conversation about 10 months ago with a friend of mine who, you know, we were talking about academic issues, you know, his situation, and I went on a 30-second rant about something political, and I said, goodness, I sound like a politician. And he said, well, as a matter of fact, you do. Have you ever thought about it? And no, you know, I hadn't thought about it. And you know, we talked a little while longer, and he said, well, why don't you talk to some people you respect and see what they say, and let's talk again. So I did, and feedback was pretty positive. So that's what pushed me into it. But, you know, I've been interested in politics since the Nixon years. And I remember the price controls. I remember the Carter years. I remember Dad getting his business loan at 21%. I used to say 17%. He corrected me when I was back in Ohio a couple weeks ago. 17% was the prime rate. He paid 21 on his loan. And the impact of politics on business is tremendous. So having followed that all of my life, and becoming, like many of us, increasingly concerned with what's happening in D.C., I'm at a point in life where I have the opportunity to try to make a difference there, and that's what I want to do.
What were you so fired up with your friend? What was the issue?
It was actually infrastructure.
Yeah.
Because I don't feel we're being strategic and thoughtful about our investments in infrastructure. And we've got to do a better job there.
What do you mean by that?
Well,
are roads
look,
and bridges are collapsing? Or
they are. They are, and we're not putting money into them. Mm-hmm. And I think what got me wound up, if I remember correctly, was President Obama's stimulus program. Mm-hmm. And he threw money at shovel-ready projects, regardless of need, and with no strategy of bringing it together in a logical way. And that's the problem, right? Infrastructure is not a stimulus package. infrastructure is a strategic decision that a country makes to invest in its future. And if you think about America without the interstate highway system, think about that for a second. It's inconceivable, right? We just can't get our head around it. But we've stopped making those investments. We've stopped building. And we've got to do it.
Well, the next big thing, according to the Obama administration, which you may disagree with, was to do that same thing with rail.
You know, I'm not opposed to that. I think there are places where investment in rail makes a lot of sense. And it you look at the Northeast Corridor. It's very successful there. In Southern California, San Diego to L.A., quite successful. The Pacific Northwest, around Chicago. There are certainly corridors where that sort of investment can spur economic development. And I think in the broad scheme, yield a pretty positive payback.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And let's go to your campaign for Congress. Now, First off, you talked about how you were sort of interested in politics for a long time. You had this conversation with your friend.
Yeah.
Then you pick this particular race, which has not only a Democratic incumbent, but basically a Republican incumbent.
Well, sort of.
That you're, you know, trying to challenge, a guy who's, you know, held the office before. Why this race of all races?
Well, you know, I think that this seat in particular is one that's sort of been a ping pong ball, right?
That's another reason. Why would you do this? Well, you work so hard, and then maybe...
because I believe I can not only win the seat, but I can hold it. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a key. You know, we need representation in Washington from New Hampshire that is consistent and will carry that message forward over a period of time, but not too long. You know,
term limits for you?
I would support.
Have you thought about it?
I would support reasonable term limits, and I will impose a 12-year term limit on myself. Mm-hmm. I don't think that that's the equivalent of two Senate terms. Mm-hmm. I think that's a reasonable time frame. It gives you enough seniority to get things done, but you don't become too entrenched, so you lose sight of why you're there. And I would go to represent New Hampshire and New Hampshire's values. So why this seat?
Yeah.
You know, I think. You know, it has been a ping pong seat. I think we as voters have expressed dissatisfaction with the two others who are interested in this seat. Each of them has been voted out of office. And I believe we need a fresh person down there. We need someone new in this seat, someone who's not a politician. And I am not a politician. I haven't lived my life as a politician. You know, again, a year ago, I would have said, no, I'm not going to be doing this.
This is your first time running.
Yeah, it is my first time running. So we need to send people to Washington who aren't politicians. Nobody likes Congress. And Congress is you know, it can be brought along, and I believe it can change. But it changes one seat at a time, and that change can start right here.
A lot of people were very disheartened, even those who really believe in the system as a conservative or as a progressive or a liberal, when the government shut down, that it would actually go to that brink and possibly hurt the nation's credit rating.
Yes.
What did you think of that moment? You were on the verge of announcing, or not announcing, that period last October.
Yeah, I think anytime you shut down the government, it's a failure of leadership. And I won't point to any one person here. It is a failure of leadership. And it's government's job to stay open, right? And in some cases, in fact, well, look, we pass budgets that we know, well, sometimes we pass budgets. Washington hasn't been real good about doing that lately. But oftentimes we'll pass a budget that we know is going to bump into the debt ceiling. And then the debt ceiling comes, everyone acts surprised, and we talk about shutting down the government. Well, come on. I mean, you knew you were creating that situation when you passed the budget. So let's address this. Business doesn't like government shutdowns. The people don't like government shutdowns. It distracts us from the issues that matter. We've got to keep government open, but we've also got to address the big problems. And that has to happen. Now, some people will say, well, you use the shutdown or the threat of it as a way to bring change. I see that argument, but I think there are better ways to get it done.
You talk a lot about fiscal issues in your campaign. It's the number one reason I think you're running. I don't want to put words in your mouth, but that's what
I hear. That's a big part of it, yeah.
What's more important to you, lower taxes or a lower deficit?
Yes, both. I mean,
well, sometimes you wouldn't raise taxes at all, revenue, to lower that deficit.
I am almost always opposed to an increase in taxes. Mm-hmm. I think that we are pretty well taxed. In fact, many of us wrote checks yesterday and would affirm that we're pretty well taxed. And we've seen historically that when we cut taxes, oftentimes the economy booms, and oftentimes government revenue actually goes up rather than down when you cut taxes. Reagan showed that it happened. You've heard, I mean, every now and then it's brought up that Kennedy wanted to cut taxes. And, you know, it's absolutely the right approach. More money in the hands of the people and less money in the hands of government is generally good policy.
And you're, just go through a couple of issues here, we're almost done here.
Yeah.
How do you feel about abortion?
Well, look, it's a tough issue, and it's one that's very emotional for people. And it's something I've struggled with all my life. I have three kids, as you know, and I can't imagine this earth without them. And I've talked to a lot of women about it. And what they tell me is, most of them, is they don't like abortion personally. They would like to see other alternatives pursued. And I'm channeling my mother right now. And, you know, she wouldn't advise anyone to get an abortion. But she doesn't believe the government should tell her she can't. And that's my position on the issue.
We've talked about, we've been in the three legs of the stool of Republican politics. We've talked a little social issues, talked fiscal issues. How do you think about foreign policy right now?
We don't have a discussion
in Republican politics right now. Well, Rand Paul, Chris Christie, interventionist or not.
We don't have a foreign policy. That's the problem. And we need one. And our foreign policy should be based on our values as a nation. So when something happens, or when a nation considers an action, they can predict with virtual certainty how we will respond. Putin should have known how we would respond to Crimea. Maybe he did, which is...
Yeah, he guessed correctly.
You know, what's the next step for him? I don't think he's done. We drew a line in Syria. It was crossed, and we didn't do anything. You can't do it that way.
I guess it goes down to the basic question for Republicans, for everyone right now. Do you think the United States should be the world's policeman?
I don't think most people think we should be the world's policeman. I think we need to look out for our own interests as a nation, and we need to do what's right. Right? I mean, genocide is a place where I would want America to step in if we see that happening in the world. If our interests are threatened, I think we should step in. But I don't believe we should be the world's policeman. I think we should cooperate with the international community to ensure that our shared values are upheld.
And you talk about the United States getting involved when it comes to something like genocide. So are you saying that the United States should get involved in Syria? I mean, that's a tough one.
Well, it is a tough one. You know, the big problem with Syria was that we drew a line.
Right.
It was crossed, and we didn't act.
Right.
And that sent a message to the global community, and it let Putin step in and make us look silly.
And what country is the biggest threat to the United States right now?
Well, there are multiple threats to the United States. The actual threats to the United States are probably relatively few. The threats to our interests are much larger. And I am concerned about what's happening with Russia. I'm concerned with what's happening in the Ukraine. It's on the doorstep of Eastern Europe. That to me is a pretty big concern right now. Are we seeing a replay of the Cold War? That's a big deal. And I hope we're not, and I hope we can take the right actions to stop this.
And President Obama has made the pivot to Asia and is concerned about the economic threat, if nothing else, from China and trying to contain them.
I mean, the United States and China are pretty tightly intertwined right now. They hold a lot of our debt.
Right.
We buy a lot of their products.
Yeah.
And we like it or not, we need one another at this point. North Korea, who knows what they'll do? And there's always uncertainty and instability in the Middle East. I think we've got to watch that carefully.
We're running out of time. Is there one particular thing? I hate this question for you. Is there one thing? I'm like the most important thing that you want people to know about you that maybe they're not going to hear every day on the campaign trail.
Yeah, I think that people are really important and people are good. And I believe firmly in our nation and its people. I believe in our ability to do the right thing. And I believe in America's values. And I want to take those values with me to D.C. and help to reverse course in Washington and be a part of what helps bring Congress's approval rating maybe above 50%. Wouldn't that be novel?
Well, how about over 10?
So. Even over 10. If we can get to double digits, we've done something. But you know, America's a great country. New Hampshire's a great state. The values that we have here, I think, reflect the values of America when it was founded. And those are the things we need in Washington.
Dan Innis, thanks so much for coming in.
Thank you.
Be safe out there on the trail.
I will.
And thank you for watching WMUR.com.